Around the World with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor here at the AAN annual meeting in Boston, Massachusetts. We hear a lot about relapsing forms of MS. We're even hearing more about primary progressive MS. Sometimes we hear a little bit less about secondary progressive multiple sclerosis. And I'm so happy to be joined here by Professor Pamela McCombe, who is at the University of Queensland in Australia. I want to thank you so much for joining us. Tell us a little bit about the study. You did a phase 1b trial. So we've heard phase 3 trials are those big trials. Phase 2 are more about safety. Phase 1 are the first time human beings are getting something. What is it that you gave patients in this trial?
So the drug or the product is called MIS-416, and it's a bacterial extract. And the bacteria are given intravenously, and they've been treated so that they're anti-inflammatory. They stop inflammation.
Now, what made you think that you would give a bacterial product to human beings?
All right. So I'm the clinician. I'm the neurologist who treats patients with multiple sclerosis. So it wasn't my idea. But the people in New Zealand, not Australia, New Zealand have been developing this for some years. And they came up with the idea of giving it because they knew it was anti-inflammatory and they knew MS had something to do with inflammation.
So what happens when you actually give it to people with multiple sclerosis?
So we've actually given it in the phase 2 trial. So I had 10 patients at my site, and we give it intravenously. Obviously, in the trial, we're not sure who had what, but at the end of the trial, everybody went on the active drug. So I can talk about what happens with the active drug. In some people, they get a bit feverish at the beginning, but generally, it's extremely well tolerated. In terms of, you know, the outcome of the trial, I don't think I should talk about that because we don't know that yet. Yeah.
How often do people get the medication?
So the medication is given once a week, and what happens is after they finish with us at the trial site, their general practitioners do it, and the patients go once a week and have the infusion and carry on. It's very quick.
Do we think we understand how it's working to reduce inflammation? We hear about different medications about affecting the cell itself, affecting the neuron, affecting the immune cells, affecting the mitochondria, the energy cells. How do we think this one works?
So this one works on what's called the innate immune system. So in MS, most of our drugs work on what's called the adaptive immune system, which is the T cells and the B cells. So this is the more primitive part of the immune system called the innate immune system, which in evolution came before the adaptive immune system. And we think the innate immune system's got a lot to do with what happens in progressive MS. In the blood, in the brain, there's inflammation, which is probably in microglia, which are innate immune cells. So what we think this drug does is it damps down that inflammation in the brain, which is bad. And we give it intravenously, obviously into the veins, but we think it eventually gets into the brain and does that.
Are there people who don't respond, who seem not to be responding to medication?
Yeah, so I mean, this is extremely preliminary, I have to say. This is based on a tiny, tiny study. And the work that I'm presenting here was looking at a reason why maybe some people would not respond or actually not respond immediately. Maybe they respond in a slower fashion. And it speaks to the diversity of patients with MS. I mean, obviously patients with MS have a range of genes that affect how strong or weak their immune system is. And we've been looking at a gene related to a thing called NF-kappa-B and shown that people whose NF-kappa-B is a bit different from other people maybe don't respond.
So that really ties back to how we think this medicine might be working. Because the people, now does that mean that we're going to maybe have blood tests or other kind of tests we'll be able to see if somebody has a genetic component and then that will help us in treatment?
So, I mean, we're jumping a bit far ahead because the trial, you know, results are not yet. But assuming that the drug showed benefit, what this poster is talking about is a test that might either explain why some people don't work or maybe able to predict who might respond or not respond. But as I would like to keep stressing, you know, the trial results are not going to be available till the end of the year.
Yeah, and that's one of the great things about coming to meeting after meeting is I think people back home get to see how some things in science come up, and then we see we can't replicate it and we forget about it, and sometimes years later we bring it back. And so there's really this fluid nature, and that's why the both the scientific process is so important, but also the regulatory process of the regulators making sure that our treatments are both safe as well as effective for our patients. Professor, I want to thank you so much for joining us, and I want to thank you back home.